29, section 1. And the title here is Taking on Segregation. And so, of course, you all know about Brown versus Board of Education in Topeka in 1953. And that's probably one of the most famous decisions reflecting on segregation. But this was the result of a widespread movement of court cases, of protests and marches, and a popular peaceful movement going on all around the country to advance equal rights for African Americans. We're going to particularly focus today in the 1950s and 60s. But first, I want to hop back and give you a little background. In 1865, at the end of the American Civil War, the 13th Amendment was passed, outlawing slavery for any reason except for punishment of a crime. And then the significant amendment was quickly followed by the 14th and 15th Amendments, the 14th being equal protection under the law. And Congress at the time was very motivated to implement civil rights for all, regardless of race. And so the Civil Rights Act of 1875 was passed, which actually outlawed segregation. And while that law was challenged, and the Supreme Court declared that law unconstitutional in the famous court case Plessy v. Ferguson, where it was ruled that a black man could not sit on the front of a train. So there was a late 1800s version of Rosa Parks. He wanted to sit on the front of a train. He was told he could not, and the United States Supreme Court ruled that he could not. And so that set the precedent of separate but equal, which continued through into the 1950s. And hearkening back to that famous ruling, many states began to pass laws requiring the separation of the races, and these were just called Jim Crow laws. And so there's lots of problems with this. You know, like what Chief Justice Earl Warren said, that separating someone, excluding someone because of their race, fosters this feeling of inferiority that stays with them through their entire life. But there's also another glaring problem. The facilities that were provided for African Americans were almost never actually equal to that of white Americans. And so there was a glaring problem with this from the very beginning. You know, the classic example of one man forced to drink from a different water fountain simply because of the color of his skin. All right, so I just wanted to show you just something really neat. You know, sometimes it's best to hear these stories from the people who were there. We'll get to the Little Rock Nine and the integration of these schools and the resistance in many southern states in just a moment, but I want to give a little more background. So after the Civil War, many of these freed slaves began to move all over the country, in particular into northern cities because that's where economic opportunities were. But yet, you know, fleeing from the South wasn't fleeing from discrimination. I mean, this was a nationwide problem that was going on. And then after the Second World War, you know, the civil rights movement gained a lot of momentum for a number of reasons. One, just very simple, that there were more job opportunities, more economic opportunities. And so, you know, the African American community was able to gain a lot of advancement. But also just, you know, those 1 million African Americans who went to fight in the Second World War. And then coming home to a nation that treated them as second class. You also have the President of the United States, FDR, Truman, and then, you know, John F. Kennedy, Lyndon Johnson, and so forth, who all believed that there needed to be an end to racial discrimination. And so as these veterans were returning home, many of them became involved and leaders in this movement to gain not only further economic opportunity, but to promote racial equality and to put an end to injustice. And so I wanted to look at a few significant Supreme Court decisions. So prior to Brown v. Board in 1954, the Purple States, which of course North Carolina, as you can see, is one of those, required segregation by law. And the Green States, you can see here, are the only ones where segregation was prohibited by 1954. So the Green States are the only ones actually complying with the Supreme Court decision. And so you have all of those purple states that resisted this decision. And in some cases, violently resisted this decision. I mean, this is not just marches and protests and cases. This is a person-to-person, a cultural movement that's going to take many people a very long time to catch on to. So how do you change something like this? You know, what's the strategy? And that's where the NAACP, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, began to focus on the glaring inequalities of segregated public education. You know, what can be demonstrated? What can be shown in a court of law? What can I take a picture of and explain without any disagreement that what is given here is not equal to what is given here? And so that's where an entire team of law students under Thurgood Marshall began to challenge these inequalities in numerous cases. Brown v. Board is obviously the most famous, but there were 32 cases argued before the Supreme Court of particular injustices and inequalities, leading up to, of course, the greatest victory here, in which in 1954 the court struck down segregation in public schools. And you saw how many states refused to allow children of one race to attend school with children of another race, with that being the only distinction. And then the process of implementing Brown v. Board is going to be fraught with controversy. So I want to give another example here. In 1960, you can see that only 20% of African Americans in the entire country had attended and completed high school. And for many, the reason's simple, that there just was not a high school in their community where they could attend legally. In Transylvania County, there was no high school for African Americans where they could legally attend, period. If they were to attend high school, they had to come to Hendersonville, where there was a black school. So again, 20% of African Americans were able to it by 1960. And by 2010, that number's up to 84%. But also let's look at income levels. So per capita income for the average African American family in 1967, adjusted for inflation. So this is $2,012. The average African American family was bringing in $8,400 a year. $8,400 a year. By 2000, the average family bringing in close to $20,000 a year. Still a long ways to go, but you can see how far we've come.
The groundwork was now set. With the Sweat and McLaren decisions, the precedents chipping away at the separate but equal doctrine were mounting up. The time had come to put the very idea of separate on trial, to prove that separate schools could never be equal. Just 2 years after his death, Charles Houston's strategy to end legal segregation was put to the final test. Reverend Oliver Brown joined a dozen other Topeka families in an NAACP lawsuit demanding their children be allowed to attend nearby white schools rather than have to cross town and ride a bus to their assigned black schools. Brown v. Board of Education was not just their case, but four other desegregation lawsuits from across the country combined by the Supreme Court into one critically important national case. Fittingly, the last case included was a Washington, D.C. suit begun by Charles Houston. Thurgood Marshall had become the chief coordinator for the Brown strategy. Once Houston's student, now Marshall stood in Houston's shoes. He was chief counsel to the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. For this most important case of all, Marshall gathered together his expert team of NAACP lawyers, including Constance Motley, Robert Carter, Jack Greenberg, James Nabrit, Oliver Hill, and Louis Redding. But he also recruited leading scholars and educators from around the nation.
I never have seen such work, such commitment, such dedication, such energy as was put into that undertaking. They kept this up, week in and week out, so that when the arguments began in December of 1953, they felt that they were ready.
Opposing Marshall as chief counsel for segregation was John W. Davis. Davis had argued over 140 cases before the Supreme Court, more than any other attorney in this century, a formidable world-famous legal opponent. On December 9th, 1952, spectators filled every seat in the Supreme Court, and 400 people lined up in the corridors, hoping to hear the foremost legal minds argue about segregation and the meaning of the Constitution. Thurgood Marshall and his team argued that segregated schools marked black children with a stamp of inferiority and affected their ability to learn. They argued that such suffering denied black people the equal protection of the law guaranteed by the 14th Amendment. John W. Davis's argument relied on the Plessy decision to justify segregation. He felt confident it would yield him yet another legal victory.
He was of the opinion that all of the precedents were on his side. Well, what he really meant was that he had Plessy Ferguson on his side because he had failed, it seems to me, in thinking that he could win the case, to consider the build-up by all of the other cases that the NAACP group and others were mounting.
For 17 months, the fate of segregation in America hung in the balance. On May 17th, 1954, the Supreme Court handed down the decision that Charles Houston had begun fighting for 20 years earlier. In a unanimous decision, the Supreme Court ruled in the Brown case, to separate children solely because of their race generates a feeling of inferiority that may affect their hearts and minds in a way unlikely ever to be undone. In the field of public education, separate but equal has no place. Separate educational facilities are inherently unequal. Any language in Plessy versus Ferguson contrary to this finding is rejected. It is so ordered.
May 17th, 1954, I was downtown, and over the radio came a unanimous Supreme Court voted today that racial segregation in the public schools is inherently unequal and unconstitutional. I was so thrilled. It was just like being born again. It was tremendous. And the people were coming out in the streets. They couldn't believe that we had won.
Oh, happy day.
Now, Brown v. versus Board of Education, I just can't emphasize how important that is and how much of a change and a shift in American policy that is. But when you have 60 years worth of Jim Crow and segregation and institutionalized racism, overcoming that can be a difficult process. But within a year, over 500 different school districts had begun to desegregate. But the problem is that many districts, many state officials, and even, you know, many pro-white groups began to actively resist this. It was at this time that the Ku Klux Klan was refounded around Stone Mountain near Atlanta, Georgia. It was at this time that many state courthouses like Columbia and South Carolina began to raise the Confederate flag in front of their state houses. Some have removed it at this point. Some continue to fly it. And that flag was raised in opposition to Brown versus Board. The court handed down a second ruling saying that this needs to be enforced. This needs to be enforced with, quote, all deliberate speed. At first, President Eisenhower refused to enforce compliance. He said, it's impossible. I can't reinvade the South. I can't just put federal troops in every single school. He said it was impossible to enforce, and so the people are going to begin to integrate schools anyway. So at the beginning of the lesson, you got to meet one of the ladies from the Little Rock Nine, and she was one of the young ladies who attended Arkansas State University. And you saw the footage. And what we didn't get to see in that first clip is how the National Guard of the state of Arkansas was ordered by the governor of Arkansas, Orville Faubus, to turn away these young people. And so, you know, students of schools throughout the South began to take it upon themselves to attend these schools anyway. You know, Elizabeth Eckford became the first African American to enroll in the University of Arkansas. And there was a crowd standing in front of the university to bar her entrance. In fact, while Eisenhower at first said, there's no way I can make this happen, she forced his hand. This young lady forced the hand of the President of the United States to do something about it. Because what? Is he going to let a crowd stop a ruling of a Supreme Court? Or are we going to allow mob rule here? And so he had to call in the United States 101st Airborne Division to escort this young lady into her classes. And then, of course, you heard the interviews of what happens when the guards go away? What happens when the soldiers leave? You know, so these people, like, risked at great peril, and in many cases got themselves killed for attending a school. And so African Americans were harassed and bullied and beaten and in some cases attacked. So anyway, I wanted to show you, this is a picture of Elizabeth Eckford attending Little Rock High School in Little Rock, Arkansas. You can see the angry crowd as she's walking by. But you can also see the National Guard from the state of Arkansas stood by. And of course, you know, this forced a confrontation that was on live television all over the country, and it forced the president to action. That young lady had an awful lot to do with integrating the schools in Arkansas.
Maybe it's just me, but college was very confusing times.
Federal troops enforcing a court order integrated the University of Alabama today. Two Negroes were admitted, but only after Governor George Wallace had carried out his symbolic threat to stand in the schoolhouse door.
Governor Wallace, I take it from that statement that you're going to stand in that
door. What's going on?
Coons are trying to get into school.
Coons? Well, raccoons trying to get on our back porch. Mama just chased them off with a broom.
Not raccoons, you idiot. Niggas. And they want to go to school with us.
With us? They do?
Shortly after Governor Wallace had carried out his promise to block the doorway, President Kennedy ordered the Secretary of Defense then to use military force. Here by videotape is the encounter by General Graham, Commander of the National Guard, and Governor Wallace.
Because these National Guardsmen who are here today as federal soldiers are Alabamians, and they live within our borders, they are our brothers. We are winning in this fight because we are awakening the American people to the dangers that we have spoken about so many times, which is so evident today, the trend toward military dictatorship in this country.
And so at day's end, the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa had been desegregated, and students Jimmy Hood and Vivian Malone had been signed up for summer classes.
Ma'am, you dropped your book. Ma'am.
Governor Wallace did what he promised to do. By being on the Tuscaloosa campus, he kept them off from gathering and preventing.
Hey, wasn't that Gump?
No, that couldn't be. Sure as hell was.
A few years later, that angry little man at the schoolhouse door thought it'd be a good idea and ran for president. But somebody thought that it wasn't. But he didn't die.
My bus is here.
Is it the number 9?
No, it's the number 4.
It was nice talking to you.
I remember when that happened. And Wallace got shot.
So, in 1955, a young officer of the NAACP, Rosa Parks, refused to give up a seat on the bus in Montgomery, Alabama. I'm sure you guys are familiar with this story, but it was decided that the authorities were not doing enough to integrate society so that young people like Elizabeth Eckford, like Rosa Parks, like the Little Rock Nine, were going to have to take matters into their own hands. And so it was decided that these people would peacefully challenge laws that were in contradiction to the Brown v. Board ruling. And so when she was arrested, she refused to walk off the bus. The police actually had to carry this lady off of the bus. And there were members of the press there documenting what happened. And the result was a bus boycott of all the public transit in Montgomery, Alabama. In fact, leading this was none other than Dr. Martin Luther King, who was then 26 years old and a minister at a Baptist church. Now, this resulted in a lawsuit because removing her from the bus, a seat that she was entitled to be in, by the ruling of the United States Supreme Court, you can't pass a state law that contradicts a ruling of the Supreme Court. And so it was challenged. It had widespread support from the black community, and many groups, many whites and blacks began to work for this. In fact, in 1956, just a couple years after Brown v. Board, the Supreme Court said specifically regarding buses that buses must be integrated.
African American.
Now, speaking of Martin Luther King, he emphasized a particular brand of resistance, nonviolent civil disobedience. That is, he chose to follow the example of Mahatma Gandhi, who refused to obey laws that he felt contradicted his moral code. So he would break the law, but he would do it in a peaceful way. So Dr. King called this soul force, that through civil disobedience, through massive demonstrations. It can be shown, it can be documented, it can be communicated to the nation that this is unacceptable. And often, members of this movement were attacked and beaten. But the power of this is it was being documented. It was being witnessed. People were watching this on television and seeing it. And you couldn't avoid it. Because, you know, whereas people will turn a blind eye to things they don't see, things they are not aware of, the power of this movement is it was forcing people to confront it. And so he founded the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, known as the SCLC, their purpose to carry on this nonviolent resistance. Some felt that a more confrontational strategy was needed, and so the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee was created as well. And so this group also adopted Dr. King's policy of nonviolence, but began to try a more confrontational approach. You know, for example, they began to use sit-ins. And sit-ins are, it's a tactic where these people would go and sit in segregated places. Oh, black people can't go to this hospital? Stop me. Oh, I'm not welcome in this restaurant? What you gonna do about it? And so the first of these sit-ins was actually in Greensboro, North Carolina, at a Woolworths there. And so, you know, you can look up pictures, you can find videos of just numerous cases of the SCLC, of the SNCC, of these young people just challenging segregated places, getting thrown out of restaurants, getting attacked, getting dogs, getting beaten. And this was so effective that public places were becoming desegregated in almost every American state. But this is what I'm talking about. So here's the Woolworths. This is Greensboro, North Carolina. You know, you see white and black young people. But then you see the response. You know, this takes guts. But again, it can be very effective. So I wanted to show you just a few more examples. You know, protest, demonstrations, mass demonstrations.